Hello everyone, my name is Katie and welcome back to my channel. Today I'm going to be talking about the books that I read in October. October was kind of weird for me because I didn't actually read that much. I was feeling very kind of burnt out and stressed and I didn't always want to be reading. But the books that I did read were very good. I also feel like I didn't read as much. I only read like one audiobook and then I kind of got into an audiobook slump after that. And then I didn't read like many ebooks or like graphic novels, comics, which tend to like increase the number of books that you read. But like, it's okay. I feel like sometimes we put a lot of pressure on ourselves as booktubers and readers in general to sustain a certain amount of reading. And if you're not feeling it and it's not making you happy, like you shouldn't have to force yourself to read. Like obviously we want to read because we love it, but like if it's putting the stress on you that you feel like you need to read 10 books a month and you can't reach that, like it's okay. Just like read what makes you comfortable. If you read half a book a month, if you read 50 books a month, like we're all equally readers here. And it's up to you to go at your own pace. Like life just gets busy sometimes and that's that. And I'm like not gonna feel bad or be like, oh, like, you know, I had such a bad reading month, because it wasn't a bad reading month. It was a great reading month. The books that I did read, I'm really glad that I spent time with them. And I spent a lot of time with them because it did take me a little bit longer to read them, but they were just all phenomenal. Most of them were 5-star, one of them was a 4-star. So like really, I spent a lot of time reading really good books this month and no regrets. Okay, so let's get this party started with Stalking Jack the Ripper by Carrie Maniscalco. Okay, if you've been around here from my past few videos, you know that I will not shut up about this series because it is my everything. This has been a buddy read with my lovely friend Isabella over at Throne of Pages, and we just have become really close pretty quickly, and we were like, you know what, like, we're friends and we're on BookTube, so like we need a buddy read something. And it was the beginning of October and I was like, you wanna know what? Stalking Jack the Ripper has been on my radar for a little bit and it's perfect for October. Spooky vibes, very spooky, like let's go. So we decided to buddy read the first book in the series and it has quickly turned into we're buddy reading the whole series together. We are currently on the last book right now and it has been just such a treasure to buddy read with her because this series is amazing. It's amazing. Stalking Jack the Ripper takes place in 1888 with the famous Jack the Ripper cases. If you are a fan of BuzzFeed Unsolved, like I am obsessed with them. Wheeze.
Hey there, demons. It's me, your boy.
Then you may have seen their Jack the Ripper episode. I love learning about true crime from Ryan and Shane. They're the best. So I have actually known a little bit of detail going in to this book because I watched that episode and I was intrigued, and I mean Jack the Ripper is a really famous case. So Audrey Rosa Wadsworth is a lady, but she does not want to conform to society's rules. While she should be hosting tea parties and running a household, what she really wants to do is study forensic medicine. And so she sneaks out and hangs out with her uncle, who is a doctor of forensic medicine, and she becomes apprentice under him. And while there, she meets her uncle's other prodigious, very smart student, Thomas Creswell. And together, basically, once the Jack the Ripper cases start occurring, the murders start occurring, that occurs to women that are prostitutes. You can look up the details of the case, and they are all pretty much seamlessly woven into this book. There is a note in the back that will explain kind of what is fictionalized and what is real. As Audrey Rose and Thomas search for clues, it brings the case closer to home than Audrey Rose could have ever imagined. Oh my god, I like, this is not the type of book that I would typically go for. Like, I had read this book description so many times, seen so many people talk about it and be like, I just don't think that would be the type of book for me. Boy, was I wrong. I am in love with this series. It is automatic 5 out of 5 stars. Carrie Maniscalco is now an Audible author for me. Her writing is phenomenal. She just has these quotes that are really powerful. I really want to read. I think this is like my favorite one. Yeah, and I drew in a little drawing here. So I was annotating, but that was actually not the quote that I was thinking of, but it calls back to this. So it says, roses have both petals and thorns, my dark flower. You needn't believe something weak because it appears delicate. Show the world your bravery. It's so good. And then here, when I drew in this rose, it was the quote, I was beautiful and dangerous at once, a rose with thorns. I was precisely who I wanted to be. Just like, Audre Rose means a lot to me because she is a woman who is fighting against the standards of her time. Like, it is not seemly for a woman of her age and standing to be dissecting bodies, but she really cares about the science. She's really smart, and she's not going to let society suffocate that intelligence, and it just makes me it makes me upset sometimes to think about all of the smart women that lived in the past that did not get a chance to fully develop their skills and their passions in the areas that they wanted to. Like, who knows, there could have been women that would have been great scientists if only they were given the resources to learn, and it makes me mad. So the fact that we have this woman going against the standards of her time, it's just fantastic. We also have Thomas Cresswell, who I love. He's just, in this book, he's very witty and flirty, but you can kind of see that he has this cold exterior that's really hiding a very kind and caring person underneath, and I just love seeing their back and forth. There is so much witty banter, so much flirting. It is some of the best flirting in a book I've ever read. Like, I was just squealing all the time. Isabella and I would just send our annotations back and forth, and like, we were just both fell head over heels for this book, and I think the experience of buddy reading it with her just has made it that much better, because there's someone that always there that I can talk to about my feelings, and I've had a lot of feelings while reading the series. I just also love how the Jack the Ripper case was incorporated into this book. I think drawing from a very well-known real life case and then spinning it into fiction can be a tricky line to draw, but Maniscalco just does it really well, where you are learning about the case, but it makes for a very compelling plot line, because Jack the Ripper case to this day is still unsolved. So I just thought it was phenomenal. Next up, I read The Beautiful by Renee Adier. This is an ARC I was sent by Penguin Teen, so thank you so much to Penguin Teen for sending this along to me. The Beautiful is the return of the vampires in YA, and I am ready for it. I was ready for it, and I hope there's more, because this book was so decadent and really, really good. And at first I thought it was going to be a duology, but apparently it's going to be a quartet. So that just makes me very excited, because I did love this first installment. The Beautiful takes place in 1872 New Orleans, which is just such an atmospheric time and glamorous time. Celine Rossio is fleeing her home of Paris and her life as a dressmaker after something incredibly dark has happened to her, and she is forced to go on the run. She's taken in by the sisters of a convent, but quickly becomes embroiled in the glittering underbelly of New Orleans, specifically the Le Cour des Lions, or the Court of Lions, and quickly catches the eye of the group's leader, Sebastian Saint Germain. When the body of one of the girls from the convent shows up in the Court of Lions, Celine must battle her attractions to Sebastian and her suspicion with his guilt, along with the shame of her own horrible secret. After a third murder, the killer now has Celine in his sights, and Celine decides she must take matters into her own hands. I gave this book 5 out of 5 stars. It was just so good. I know that Renee Adier is known for having beautiful writing, and The Beautiful did not disappoint with the writing. It's just full of lyrical and glitzy prose that really just puts you right in the atmosphere of New Orleans. If you've ever visited New Orleans, you kind of just know that the city has a feel to it, and I think that this book probably gives that feeling to the reader. And especially like this time period, it's just something that I really wanted to sink my teeth into. I was instantly captivated by Celine. She has this very hard inner struggle dealing with what had happened to her in the past and why she's fleeing and how she tries to escape that and move on from that in New Orleans, but kind of her past comes back to haunt her. And the romance between Sebastian and Celine was, again, it was great. They were just kind of, it's like a fatal attraction thing where they shouldn't be attracted to each other, but they are. And the way that the tension builds between them is really, really good. We also have Odette, who is a side character, and she's great. She is in the Court of Lions, and she, in polite society, dresses as a woman, but when she is in the Court of Lions, she like dresses in trousers, and she doesn't want to live by society's rules. And the Court of Lions itself is just very intriguing. One of the complaints I've heard about this book is that there weren't enough vampires, and I can see where the vampires will feature more prominently in the future books, but for me it didn't quite bother me. Even though this was pitched as a vampire book, I kind of like slowly discovering the lore of the world as our main character, who is not a vampire, is discovering it. So she's just coming to New Orleans as a normal girl, and then gets involved in the Court of Lions, and then realizes that things aren't quite what they seem, and through her we get to see kind of how she figures out what is actually going on, what sort of creatures are involved. And we also get some chapters from the perspective of the killer, and I thought that just made for a really interesting aspect of the plot. Like, when it comes together in the end, it just takes you by surprise, and then you're like, I should have seen that coming. But that's kind of like the best plot twist. It ended with a bang. I think it's going to set up for a very interesting book two, and it's kind of like a trope that I know some people aren't a fan of, but I haven't seen it done in a while, so I really think that it can be done well. And I don't know, the next book is coming out in June, which is really exciting because normally you have to wait a whole year for a sequel, but we're getting it only a few months, well, like half a year after the first book, which is just great. Next, I listened to American Royals by Katherine McGee. This is the only audiobook that I listened to this month. American Royals is set in an alternative universe where when America won the Revolutionary War, instead of creating a democracy, we put George Washington on the throne and thus created the Washington line. We follow the three main heirs to the throne, Princess Beatrice, who must choose duty over everything as she is next in line to rule the country, Princess Samantha, or Sam, who is kind of used to being the spare and acts out, but when she wants the one man that she actually can't have, things go haywire, and Prince Geoffrey, who has two women vying for his heart. It was honestly such a fun, juicy read. It felt like I was listening to an episode of Gossip Girl meets Royals. The romance and the intrigue was off the charts, and it was just very angsty. If you were looking for a fun, lighthearted read, I would totally recommend this book because I think it is just something that you can fly through because of how fun it is. We get multiple perspectives from Beatrice, Sam, Nina, and Daphne. Each character had their own struggles, but they each had a very distinct voice, so you could kind of understand what was going on in each chapter. I definitely think the character that I felt the most for was Beatrice because girl was going through it. She had the weight of America on her shoulders, and she just wanted to follow her heart, and her position made it very hard for her to do that, and I think that was maybe my favorite romance arc in the story. Each sibling does have a different romantic arc. Nina is Princess Sam's best friend, who is just like a common person, and we see her being adjacent to the royals her whole life, how that affects her and her struggles, and I don't think that they were always the best of friends with each other at times, but I did enjoy seeing that dynamic of friendship played out on page. And American Royals will be having a sequel, so I'm very excited to get my hands on it eventually when it comes out, because I think it's just going to be a blast again, and I did give this 4 out of 5 stars. Next up is a graphic novel series that I'm absolutely, absolutely obsessed with, and that is Monstrous. Specifically, I read Monstrous Volume 1, Awakening, and this is just like, I was actually reading a little bit about it on the internet, and the author, I think, kind of got inspired by the way that women were treated in Game of Thrones, and so this is like a high fantasy matriarchal society where we have Maika Half-Wolf, who has a psychic link with this monster, thus making her the Monstress. There has been this war between the Arcanics, which can sometimes look human, but also sometimes have animalistic features, and the humans, which also have this order of witches that are trying to harvest the Arcanics for their blood because it gives them power. This comic series starts out with Maika infiltrating the witch's lair and trying to learn information there as she is on a mission to learn the secret of this monster inside of her and what happened to her mother. And oh man, it is just good. It's just like the world building is phenomenal. Like the pictures, I don't know, there's just something about seeing a type of novel that I would love to read about in picture form, and the pictures just being absolutely phenomenal. Just, it blows me away every single time that I read it, and I just cannot stop thinking about this series, and I wish that there were more out. Let's see, I'll show some of the chapter headings because they're really gorgeous. I actually saw Brittany from Brittany the Bibliophile talking about this series, and I had seen other people talking about it too, but that's kind of when I was like, you know what, Brittany and I have pretty similar tastes. If she likes it, I think I'll like it, and I have been in love with the series ever since I picked it up. Here is, so like we have this picture. There's also this little fox girl who is my favorite. Her name is Kippa. She's just like the best character ever. And we have Master Ren, who is a talking cat. And I always love a good talking cat, especially a smart ass talking cat in my novels. So So I ended up giving this book 5 out of 5 stars because I'm completely in love, obsessed, the art style, the world, and Maika, who like just struggles so much with having this monster inside of her and like morally the ramifications of that, and we kind of like get more of her backstory of how she grew up, and it's just like it's so gripping and so good, and I am just enraptured with this comic series. And as you go along, you just learn more of the lore and the mythology of the world, and it's expertly crafted. I just think it's so good. I cannot say more. I cannot even like express how good it is. I just love it that much. Next, I read Hunting Prince Dracula. Again, buddy read this with Issa, and like, the second book was even better. It was so good. 5 out of 5 stars. In this second novel, we see Audrey Rose and Thomas Creswell headed off to Romania to try and, I guess, do like a pre-program to earn a spot in this prestigious forensic academy that is in one of the old castles of Vlad Dracul in Romania. And I just like love the Romanian setting. In this town where the academy slash castle is, all of these people are turning up murdered, drained of blood, with 2 incisions on their neck, pretty much looking like vampires. And there is hysteria in the town because of course they believe in the supernatural and the legend of Vlad Dracula, or Vlad the Impaler, and like it's so good. The mystery is just like shrouded in Romanian folklore, and it was really cool to kind of step out of London and get this very gothic sort of feel in the Romanian and vampire-y setting. There were some twists and turns in this novel that literally had my heart pounding. Like, I was afraid of what was going to happen to my beloved Audrey Rose and Thomas Creswell. I also think that this book does a very good job of portraying PTSD, because after the events of Stalking Jack the Ripper, Audrey Rose has a lot to deal with emotionally. And I think that Carrie Maniscalco portrayed that very well. Like, it wasn't just like it had happened and, you know, Audrey Rose was fine. Like, there were a lot of emotional scars that she had from that experience. And, you know, she just has a lot of anxiety that she has to overcome. And I just think it's expertly done. And Thomas Creswell has captivated my heart. He has got to be one of my favorite fictional men, because just the way that he flirts, but then he's like so kind and caring. And the way that he treats Audrey Rose, they just have such mutual love and respect for each other, and it kills me. Like, they're my favorite ship, I think, at the moment. Like, I just love them so much. It hurts a little bit. So this relationship is just such a breath of fresh air, especially in a time period where women didn't have agency in relationships. It's just like such a great portrayal, and I will love them forever and ever. And finally, the last book that I read in October is Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. I did go to a signing, so my copy is signed. I actually didn't annotate this one because I was just reading through it so quickly, I didn't want to stop to annotate. But if I were ever to reread, I think I would want to annotate it, because there's just like a lot going on here. Ninth House has got to be one of the most hyped books of the year. It is by our queen of the Grishaverse, Leigh Bardugo, and she is taking a plunge into adult fiction. Please note that this is an adult book. There is a lot of trigger warnings for sexual abuse, violence, some kind of gross things going on, drug use. The list goes on and on, but it definitely is dark, but it's not like the super dark without like hope or humor that I thought it was going to be, because Leigh Bardugo is actually very funny, and there are some very funny parts in this book. Ninth House is about Galaxy Stern, who wakes up in the hospital after pretty much all of her friends die in this unsolved multiple homicide, and she's offered a chance to attend Yale on a scholarship and monitor the secret societies of Yale. There are 8 houses, and 9th house is Leith, which is the house that Alex is asked to join. The 8 windowless tombs are well-known haunts of the rich and powerful, and Alex completely does not fit in the world of Yale. She is someone that has struggled so much at such a young age. I just absolutely adored the fact, okay, I give this book 5 out of 5 stars. I think there are very divided opinions from what I've seen of people, but I just like absolutely fell in love with this book. I think it's really cool to see something that you know in real life and then make it supernatural, like add another layer to the real world, and like it's just done so well. and while also making a lot of commentary on privilege in the Ivy League and at these types of colleges and with these types of secret societies. It's just so well done. Alex is such a great character because she's almost a little bit of an unreliable narrator, because you just like know that she just has this will to survive and she will do what is best for her to make sure that she is preserving herself. Self-preservation runs very strong with her, and yet you see how she kind of ends up caring about these people. This book starts out with the kind of epilogue as a prologue, which is a literary device that I absolutely love, because it's kind of like, okay, like what is going on and how did we get here? And then we have flipping perspectives between the fall told from the perspective of Darlington, who is Alex's mentor at Leith, and winter when something has happened, Darlington is missing, and now Alex must try to bring him back. And it's interesting learning from Darlington's chapters, because you can just like, I adore Darlington as a character, and I really hope that we get more of him in the upcoming books. I think Lee said that she like envisioned this as like a 5-book series, and I'm all here for it. Like, please give me more. The different societies, and each one has like a special kind of magic that they use. Like, the type of magic in each one is just like very twisted and weird. The rituals are crazy, and it's so good. Like, I cannot properly express how much I love this book and how phenomenal I think it is. All right, so that does it for all the books that I read in October. As you can see, it was a month filled with some very phenomenal reads. Everything that I read physically was a 5-star, and my 1 4-star audiobook. I just love that I got to experience all these stories and just had a month where everything that I was reading was good. I just love when that happens. Please let me know down below what your favorite read of October was, and if you've read any of these books that I talked about, what you thought about them. And then I had some fun, read some books, and I'll catch you guys in the next one.